What's going on, guys? Good morning. How are you? Well, we're
good
getting
morning,
ready.
Good morning.
We're getting ready to get started. Getting ready to get started. That's a tongue twister.
You guys can actually keep talking because we still have a couple of minutes. So this is a really good time if you need to check your kids in to our awesome Up Kids or We Kids or Grow Kids or all the kids. Yep. Now's a good time to do that. Or if you need the restroom, we don't have coffee anymore. So, yeah, boo.
Oh, man.
But if you need water or something, now's a good time to go do that.
Yeah. So we wanted to also ask you guys a question. I went to the Applejack Festival yesterday. Have you guys heard of that? Yeah?
I've never been.
It's super fun.
I've never been.
They used to do it only one day, but now they spread it out because of COVID and all that stuff. But so everybody, I think, can agree on this, I hope. Nobody likes bad apples, right? Right? Oh, those like ones that are like mushy or really bruised. So I love Pink Lady apples.
Anyone else like Pink
Fuji.
Lady apples?
Right? Those are the best, right?
Are those
they're
like the really crunchy,
yeah, they're
expensive
great.
Ones? Okay.
I'm kind of bougie. I like the expensive apples, okay?
Josh is bougie. Some of you don't know what that means. It's fine. Bougie. Is there...
Yeah. Oh, man, if I could get them at Whole Foods all the time, you know? But I call Whole Foods Whole Paycheck, so I can't really afford it, but I like to joke like I well,
Fresh Thyme. Oh, yeah. Fresh Thyme does have them on sale. You see, that's what this time is for. It's so you guys can, like, inform us. Any Valas fans here?
Hey.
Okay. That's it? You
yeah,
guys,
come on.
Thank you.
The
guys, we need to show up. We've got to go. I think a group of us should get together and just go.
Let's do it.
That would be awesome.
A bonfire.
Well, anyway, we'll be back in a little bit. Welcome, you guys. It's so good that you're here this morning. Just keep chatting, smiling, doing what you do, talking about apples and all that, Valas and all that stuff.
Apples.
Good morning again. My name is Carissa Carter, the worship director here, and this is my friend...
Josh Hoffman.
Nice.
I'm also part of the worship team. And the tech department, right?
Yeah.
So, how are you guys? We hope you're doing well. I know we were just talking about apples and random stuff. You
and
guys
Valas.
Probably like, why the heck are they talking about that? But we really love to get you guys engaged, chatting with each other, with us. We love that kind of stuff. Community, right? So we wanted to welcome everybody here and on live stream. I've gotten the privilege of meeting quite a few of the people that are relatively new coming back, and I love that. So if you are new, whether you're online or in the building, shoot us a text. We want to make sure that we're able to connect with you. Text guest to 402-207-8640. If you are here, please come say hi to me. I really want to meet you. In between services, I'm going to be right over here in the new guest welcome center.
Yeah, we love visitors here at Good News Church, and so just give us a chance to meet you today. And also, we just want to thank you for your generosity. We have such an amazing Good News family, and we love that you give. It's part of worship in the Bible. It's also just part of worship here at Good News Church, so thank you so much for doing that. If you want to give, you can actually get on your phone right at this moment as we're talking, and you can text Good News Omaha to 77977, or you can go to mygoodnews.church and you can click on give if you'd rather not do that, which I understand. We have our drop boxes that are in the lobby, so you can do that in person as well.
We have a few fun things coming up in the next week. Krista, would you mind telling us about what's going on Monday?
Yeah, so I'm coming tomorrow night to the annual business meeting. I hope that if you're a member that you're going to join us tomorrow night. Yeah. 6:30, if you go to the info center, you can grab a packet on new deacons, or just our deacon candidates. Yep. Excuse me. So members, come on out, especially our younger members. We want to see you guys and kind of get used to the consistency of membership here at Good News Church.
Also, we have interpretation that's back. So this is really, really cool. We have French and Chinese available right now. Isn't that incredible?
Yeah.
The fact that we need interpretation, how cool is that? And the fact that we have a team that is built to be able to take care of that is also really cool. We are looking for a Spanish interpreter, though. So if you or somebody that you know would be interested in using your gifts as part of that team, we would love to connect with you. Come talk to somebody at the info desk, or if you're online, give us a call. We would love to talk to you.
Muy bien.
Buenos dias.
Arrivederci. Okay, bad. Moving on. ladies, we are having what we call a recharge night. It is a free night of worship just for the ladies, and it's going to be just for the ladies. Let me hear you. There you go. It's going to be Friday night, October 2nd at 6:30. There is no childcare that night. We actually want you to just start getting your childcare plans set up in advance. Leave your kiddos home so that you can come enjoy a night with us. Youth, young adult ladies, we would love to see you. And then afterwards, we're going to hang out. We're going to have some snacks and do community like only ladies know how to do. So please join us that night.
So fellas, here's the deal, right? This is your time to step up. So you don't have to just be the dad of the kids, right? Dad, grandpa, uncle,
friend.
Brother, friend, whatever, right? There's probably people here that, you know, maybe they need somebody to help out. Maybe the dad is working, right? So this is your opportunity to step up and to help out. Okay, so that these ladies can come and be recharged.
Absolutely.
Right? There,
you see? Thank you, ladies. There, come on. I love that. Next week is Sunday.
It is.
Next week is Sunday the 27th. It's Vision Sunday. We're really, really excited about what God is doing here at Good News. And so we're going to launch a series on vision. In addition to that, we are going to bless our Good News family with pasta.
Yes.
So it's vision and pasta. You have to, you can put your hands together for that, because anytime there's pasta coming with anything that's said and done, that's a win. So we want you here next week just to say thank you to our Good News family for being a part of us, for just your support and your consistency. So make sure to come, actually the next couple of weeks, but Pasta Sunday next week.
That's what we call a blessing, if I ever heard one, right? So also Wednesday, we're doing the City Serve Blood Drive here. So I don't know if you guys read your Bible or not. I hope so. But Leviticus talks about that there is life in the blood.
Hey.
All right?
Josh getting like Old Testament.
Yeah. I wish I could take all the credit for that. But we want you guys to be here. It'll be from 10 a.m. to 4 p.m. So sign up ahead of time.
Yeah.
I mean, come on. You got a little bit of blood in your veins, right? Come on, give it. All right? That's what we're talking about.
I'm not sure how to follow that, but why don't you guys go ahead and stand this morning? Let's just prepare our hearts for a time of worship. And whether you're here or you're with us online, we just invite you to do whatever you need to do. Put your mind on Jesus this morning. Just lift your hands. Just begin to declare who He is. And let's prepare our hearts for a time of worship.
Nothing is better. guys something. Ezekiel chapter 37 said, this is right after he's talking about God told him to prophesy over the valley of the bones, right? And he prophesies over these bones, and he sees, you know, in this vision, he sees skin and muscle growing onto these bones, right? And he said, then he said to me, prophesy to the breath, prophesy, son of man, and say to the breath, thus says the Lord God, come from the winds, O breath, and breathe in these slain, that they may live. So I prophesied as he commanded me, and the breath came then, and they lived and stood on their feet in an exceedingly great army, okay? Therefore, this is what I'm saying to you guys today. Therefore, prophesy and say to them, thus says the Lord God, behold, I will open your graves and raise you from your graves. O my people, I will bring you into the land of Israel. I'm going to break that down for you. The land of Israel is the promise, okay? And God is saying the things that are dead in your life, right? The things that you think are buried and gone, he's bringing them back to life, and he's bringing them into the promise, okay? So as we're singing this, he brings graves into gardens. He brings bones into armies, right? That's what he's talking about. He's talking about the dead things in your life that you think are dead and gone, buried, don't have anything to do with. He's saying, no, those are the armies that are going to walk you into the promise that he has for your life. Y'all hear me? Okay, we're going to sing that again. I want you to sing it like that. You're the army that's going to walk into the promise.
Nothing better than you, Father. God, we lift our hands and our voices to you, God. We just lift up a shout. We declare that there's nothing better than the name of Jesus. There's nothing better. There's nothing stronger than the power and the blood of Jesus Christ, Lord. We thank you for transformed lives here at Good News Church, God. We thank you for transformed lives and families, God. We thank you for what you're doing. God, I'm thankful for what you're doing in my life, oh God. Can we just take a moment just to thank him this morning? God, thank you for the transformation, Lord, in my life, in my family's life, God, and what you're doing in this church, God. Thank you that it's a new day, Father God. Thank you that the plans and the purposes of who you are and what you do cannot be stopped, that you are on the throne, Father. God, we declare your rule. We declare your reign, Father, your kingdom. Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you. I just want to share this with you as we're talking about the name Jesus. You know, I share this Wednesday night, and for some reason, this is for somebody here that I'm supposed to share this again briefly. But my daughter had a son, and he was supposed to be born in October, and he was born 2.5 months too early. And when he was born, they first said right off the bat, you know, there's some bleeding in the brain. And can I tell you, there was one name that we called upon. And every night, I couldn't go to the hospital, but every night I told my daughter, FaceTime me. That's all I need is some FaceTime. And I began to prophesy. I began to pray over him that God has a plan for your life, that he's not abandoned you, that he's still the God that healeth thee. So I don't know who this is for somebody in here today, but I'm here to tell you today, you know what? I don't know if it's a mental situation, physical situation, financial situation, marital situation. All I got to do is tell you this. Jesus is still the one that when you call upon his name, he can still breathe life into a dead situation. That's who the God is that we serve today. And if your situation seems to be dead, I'm here tonight to tell you, you've come too late to tell me it doesn't work. But Jesus wants you to know today, to interrupt this service enough for me to step up here, which this was not planned, to tell you today, your situation is not hopeless. And the God who is faithful says that if you call upon his name, he will answer. So today, as they continue to sing that song, I don't know what your situation is today, at home or here, but you need to give it up. You need to release it and say, Jesus, you are my only hope. And let me tell you something. That little dude not only came home way early, he got out of the hospital on my birthday. I held him even yesterday, and as I was holding him, I was just looking at him. He's just a little dude, but I just said, man, God, you are so worthy. Tears just running down my eyes onto him. And I said, you know what? You're going to change a generation because of your witness. And you're going to change a generation in this sanctuary because of your witness. But you've got to trust him today. Sing that song, Jesus. Come on, just give it to him today.
That the shadows can't deny. Your name cannot be overcome. Your name is alive, forever lifted high.
Come on, sing it out. Or declare it. Cannot be overcome.
Cannot be overcome.
Before we were even thinking about our sin, he laid his life down. Would you just begin with all of your heart, with all of your emotion, with everything that you are, would you just begin to worship him? Would you begin to praise him? Would you begin to pour out your love upon him? Jesus, we love you. We love you. We love you. You're worthy, Jesus. You're worthy, Jesus. In every season, in every season, you're worthy. In brokenness, you're worthy. You're worthy. Explain something. There are many of you that have been in church for a long time, right? Many of you that have been walking with Jesus, but we have some younger individuals here, perhaps some people that have not been walking with the Lord for as long. This right here is what we will label as a holy moment, okay? It's a moment where the Spirit of God is saying things. Perhaps there's something in your heart that you feel a thought or something in you right now. Okay, we're going to be quiet. I'm going to ask Aaron to stop the music. I'm going to pray that God, that the Spirit of the living God will speak to you. The name of Jesus may be exalted. Let's take a moment. God, we thank you for your Spirit. I thank you, God, that your Spirit reveals things unknown to us. I thank you that it's by your Spirit, God, that we're able to walk and live a holy life. I thank you, God, that through your Spirit, you reveal mysteries to your people. Thank you that you reveal your love, your compassion, your grace, and your mercy through the Holy Spirit. I thank you, God, that right now you're speaking to your people through your Spirit. I thank you, God, for visions and dreams. I thank you for revealing those past hurts, God. I pray that you would deal with those hurts even now, all those wounds, God.
Father, no scar tissue in Jesus' name. No scar tissues in Jesus' name. God, no internal scars, God, but I pray that we may have external scars that others may wonder what happened there, and that we may be able to speak specifically to that situation and bring hope to the lives of those around us. God, thank you. We praise you in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, well, you may hug somebody, give somebody a high five. This has been a little unconventional. Good morning, Good News Church. Good morning, family. I'm going to tell you this. I'm just so excited to see so many of you here, so many of the family of God here, and it just truly blesses me. It really does, to hear you worship Jesus, to hear your adoration, your love for him. It truly does. And to see your different physical expressions of how you worship Jesus is truly a blessing to me, and I know it is the same for our pastoral team up here. And well, today we're going to continue on the series of what a disciple is, or who a disciple is. And in the last couple of weeks, we've been talking about this, and we've seen from the book, Disciple Making Is, How to Live a Great Commission with Passion and Confidence by Dave Early and Rob Dempsey. And we know that the disciple is someone that is sacrificial, and we know that a disciple is someone that is also relational, right? Pastor Jason talked to us about a disciple being someone that's sacrificial, and then Pastor Isaiah last week talked to us about a disciple being someone relational. Today, we're going to unpack the third characteristic of a disciple, that is, a disciple is transformational. Let's pray. Father, I thank you so much for your word. I thank you for your revelation, the way that you reveal yourself through the scriptures, God. I thank you for your spirit. I thank you, God, for your people. I pray, God, for every ear to be open in Jesus' name to hear what your spirit is saying. I pray, God, that we'll hide ourselves behind the cross of Christ. I pray, God, that you may be magnified, that the name of Jesus may be glorified and exalted in this place and in our lives, God. I pray that your people will learn, that we may all learn how to apply the scriptures, how to apply the principles found in scripture, and obey the leading of the spirit as we move forward to bring transformation into our sphere of influence, God. We love you and praise you in Jesus' name. And all God's people say, amen. Amen. I am super excited. Are you? Come on. You got to talk to me, because I don't think I've seen this many of you in a while. So we're going to have fun. All right. So in the book, Disciple Making Is, there's a description or a definition of a disciple that I really, really love. And it says this. It says, a disciple is a person who has trusted Christ for salvation and has surrendered completely to him. He or she is committed to practicing the spiritual disciplines in community. Okay? Spiritual disciplines, it's like, hey, when we pray, we read the Bible, we give, we gather together with all the believers, right? All of those things, spiritual disciplines in community, and developing to their full potential. Say full potential. And we're going to be talking about that today, for Christ and his mission. So 2 weeks ago, Pastor Jason said, like I said, that that a disciple, someone that's sacrificial. I've been reading this book by Mark Batterson. It's called All In. You are one decision away from a totally different life. And in page 13, right at the beginning of chapter 1, it smacks you right between the sockets right here. I'm going to read just a few lines of what it says here, chapter 1. And it says this: a century ago, a band of brave souls became known as the one-way missionaries. They purchased single tickets to the mission field without the return half. And instead of suitcases, they packed their few earthly belongings in coffins. As they sailed out of port, They waved goodbye to everyone they loved, everything they knew. They knew they've never returned home. A.W. Milne was one of those missionaries. He set sail for New Hebrides in the South Pacific, knowing full well that the headhunters who lived there had martyred every missionary before him. Milne did not fear for his life because he had already died to himself. His coffin was packed. For 45 years, he lived among the tribe and loved them. When he died, the tribe members buried him in the middle of their village and inscribed this epitaph on his tombstone. Check this out. This is what they wrote on his tombstone. When he came, there was no light. When he left, there was no darkness. Come on. That's the life of a disciple. Totally surrender. And I love what Pastor Batterson says at the end of that. He says, Jesus didn't die to keep us safe. Hello? He died to make us dangerous. Faithfulness is not holding the fort. It's storming the gates of hell. Come on. I mean, I'm telling you. Following Jesus should cost us, right? And perhaps it's not going to cost us our life like A.W. Milne. But what have you given up to follow Jesus? What are you willing to say, Jesus, here, you have it? And he may perhaps be asking for that very thing. See, surrendering it all to Jesus is not just a spiritual concept. It's a requirement. It was a prerequisite. Jesus says in Luke chapter 9, verse 23, he says it clearly. He says that if anyone was to come after me, he must first, what? Deny himself and carry what? Carry his cross daily and come after me. That is no option. That's not like a choice that I have. That's something that I must do. So a disciple is sacrificial. I love what Pastor Jason said. He says that as a disciple, you get to experience things that you don't experience as a follower. See, because Jesus, we find Jesus in many different times when he is sharing a parable or a story and then pulls his disciples to the side and they say, hey, what did you mean? And he explains it to them. That's the beauty of being the disciple. You get to actually hear firsthand what God is revealing, right? And another thing that Pastor Jason said is that in the feeding of the 5,000, he gave that miracle as an example. That as a disciple, you get to experience things that the followers don't. Why? Because as a follower, you experience the miracle. You're able to see it. But as a disciple, you actually get to participate in the miracle. And I'm going to echo what Pastor Jason said. He said that I want you to be a participant in the miracle. Come on. Somebody ought to get excited about that because you're not just a bystander. You understand this? You're not just a bystander. You get to participate in what Jesus is doing in the world and bringing transformation. Then Pastor Isaiah last week did a great job, and he talked about the fact that a disciple is someone who is relational. And he talked about that discipleship is one-on-one. It's life on life. It is an invitation to come be with me. And I love that. He talked about his experience as a young man, as a teenager. And he talked to us about Jared Cunningham, his small group leader, who at the time used to drive from North Omaha down to Bellevue and then go all the way to Millard to take him to small group. And then he would go from Millard back to Bellevue and back home to North Omaha every week. I wonder if Jared knew the impact that was going to make in a young man's life. Do you understand what I'm saying? Just giving a teenager a ride to small group and leading a small group. Simple enough, right? But now guess what? Now Isaiah has grown up to be a man of God who has been discipling our kids and families, who's now discipling young teenagers who my son and daughter are part of that, and perhaps yours are too. Just because a small investment that another young man made of giving him a ride. Let me tell you this, church. Good news, family. Your investment in other people matters. I'm going to say that again just in case we didn't catch it. Your investment in other people matter. And why am I so passionate about this? Because I have a hard time with it. Just being honest with you, I could come up with a gazillion reasons why I can't do something like this. I don't have the time. I definitely have way too many relationships, right? Well, somebody else can do it. Whatever. I don't know what your excuse could be. I don't know how. I'm not good enough. I have not reached the spiritual maturity that I should have in order to do this. Guess what? There's somebody in your life right now that knows a lot less about Jesus than you do. It's just the truth. Because if you know Jesus saves, if you know he's able to transform, if you know that he's a healer, if you know that he is the Son of God that came to actually deliver us, and that your future is in his hands, that you have a destiny and a purpose in life because of what he has done, you know more than most of the people around you. So God is challenging me. So therefore, I have to share the love. That's what we do. Ooh, I haven't even gotten to my point yet. Okay. All right. So Pastor Jason, a couple of weeks ago, he used Peter as an example. And so I love Peter because of the same reasons Pastor Jason loved Peter, because we both been really messed up. So Peter was this guy that always seemed to find himself messing up, putting his foot in his mouth and speaking before he actually fully formulated his thoughts. So I relate to him. So today we're going to talk about Peter once again. And Pastor Isaiah talks, he shared from Acts chapter 2, verses 42 through 47, I think, last week. So I'm going to pick up on Acts chapter 2 as well. So we're going to read about something that happened. And in this Acts chapter 2, beginning in verse 14, we find Peter now getting up before all of Jerusalem and sharing a message. This happened right after the outpouring of the Holy Spirit at the beginning of Acts chapter 2, when the Holy Spirit comes down and there was a sound as the wind, and there were tongues of fire that showed up, and they started speaking in other tongues and languages. And so that happened, and people were criticizing and mocking what was going on. So let's begin right there. Acts chapter 2, beginning in verse 14. And I'm going to read 14 through 18. And it says this: Then Peter stood with the 11, raised his voice, and addressed the crowd. Fellow Jews and all who live in Jerusalem, let me explain this to you. Listen carefully to what I say. These people are not drunk, as you suppose. It's only 9 in the morning. No, this is what was spoken by the prophet Joel. In the last days, God says, I will pour out my spirit on all people. Your sons and daughters will prophesy, and your young men will see visions, and all men will dream dreams. Even my servants, both men and women, I will pour out my spirit in those days, and they will prophesy. See, a disciple is transformational, transformational. In order to be transformed as a believer, as a disciple of Christ, first, we must be filled with the Spirit of God. We must be filled with the Spirit of God. See, in this first message, Peter is addressing all these bewildered people who have seen now that others are speaking in their own native tongues, and they don't understand it. And he's addressing this. Why? Because there's some mocking going on, ridiculing what's happening, right? Does this sound familiar? It still goes on today, right? It's like, oh, this speaking in tongues thing, and what is that? And I don't understand it, and mocking it. And he's bringing it to attention, because the reason why he brings Joel, the prophet Joel, is because Joel chapter 2, verse 28 to 32, it was a prophecy. And every devout Jew of the time, wanted to see that prophecy come to fulfillment. So now get this. This is what happens. He's telling them, I say, hey, guys, this thing that you're mocking is the same thing that you've been waiting for. And it's happening right before your eyes. How many times have we missed something that God is doing right in our midst, right in the middle of where we're at, just because it doesn't fit our context or our nice little box? It doesn't fit our neat Christianity or theology. Therefore, if I've never seen that before, it cannot possibly be God. So how many things are we willing to miss in order to actually take a moment, look, see? Because see, we have the benefit right here, right now, to have the Spirit of God. And I've seen things in the past where the Spirit of God in me says, that ain't me. Maybe your spirit speaks a little bit more proper English than mine, but that ain't me. But there's some other times, like when we were doing right here, during worship, when we were singing and praising God, and my brother, Pastor Terry Brown, comes up and says, I got something to say. My spirit said, yeah, right now. And then he's waiting, like, you know, like jump rope, like, when do I get in? And trying to get in. I say, no, get up there now. And he's like, right now? I say, yeah, right now. Why? Because God has something to say in that moment. But we can't miss those moments. So Peter's letting them know. Had it not been for Peter, they would have missed the whole thing. If Peter doesn't get up at that moment and shares what God put in his heart to share, because it was a timely word, would have missed it. I got to move on. So I am so glad. I am so thankful that my God is able to do the inexplainable. That my God is in the business of miracles. Because if he is held back because of my small little mind, then we got a problem. Just going to say that. Anyway, let's talk a little bit more about Peter. So Peter continues on in verse 22. So 22 through 24, this is what it says. And he says, fellow Israelites, listen to this. Jesus of Nazareth was a man accredited by God to you by miracles, wonders, and signs, which God did among you through him, as you yourselves know. Verse 23, this man was handed over to you by God's deliberate plan and foreknowledge, and you, with the help of wicked men, put him to death by nailing him on the cross. But God raised him from the dead, freeing him from the agony of death, because it was impossible for death to keep its hold on him. I absolutely love these verses. On verse 22, he says, Jesus of Nazareth was accredited to you by God, by his miracles, by his wonders, by his signs. Listen, he's telling them, hey guys, this Jesus that we're talking about here, you all seen what he can do. Because he told them, as you know, as is known by you, you know what God has done. You know the first actual visible and apparent miracle to me in my life was my salvation. Was my salvation. Why? Because I used to be lost and now I'm found because I love my sin. And then Jesus came in the picture and boom, he wrecked my life. So guess what? People around me were like, that's not Raphael. That cannot possibly be Raphael. You mean that he doesn't cuss anymore? You mean that he's not after this anymore and after that anymore and using that anymore? That is impossible. How does that happen overnight? It's a miracle. I can't explain it to you. The miracle of salvation to me is very, very real. And perhaps it is to you, because I don't know how to explain that 1 second at 8:59, I am this way, and at 9:01, I am that way. It doesn't just happen. It is the God of the inexplainable. It's the God of the miracle. So that's how he's telling them. He said, hey guys, you seen what he did? But then, oh boy, but then you really see the growth of Peter. Verse 23, he says, this man was handed over to you by God's deliberate plan and foreknowledge. And I'm not going to read the scriptures because I was going to go into them. But you can find it in every single, no, not that one. That one is not the one in every single gospel. But in Matthew chapter 16, and I'm going to give you the reference, 16:21-23. We find that Jesus explains to his disciples that he's going to die. And you remember what Peter did when he got so uncomfortable? Because Jesus dying was going to mess up all of Peter's plans, according to Peter. Because if Jesus dies, then, hey, we don't get to sit on the throne with you as we take care of this Roman oppression and as we deliver the people. So if you die, that's a problem. So when Jesus shared that he was going to die, what did Peter do? He said, not Lord, that surely should not happen to you. Right? He pulled Jesus aside and rebuked him. Boy, I tell you what, I think he was a little crazier than me. And Jesus says, get behind me, Satan. Jesus says, Peter, listen, Peter, you have the things of man in your mind, not the things of God. He was refusing the fact that God sent his son, Jesus, as Messiah, and he must suffer. But here, he tells them, all of Israel, he says, God's delivered plan and foreknowledge. This man was handed over to you. That's in verse 23 of Acts 2. This man was handed over to you by God's delivered plan and foreknowledge. You know what's happened to Peter? Transformation. After the Spirit of God came upon him, now he's a different man. Now he sees that it is not for my sake, it's for the whole world. Now he doesn't only have the things of man in his mind, he has the things of God in his mind and Jesus' mission in his mind. Do you see the difference? And then further proof, he goes on to say, and this is in every gospel, in Matthew 26, Mark 14, Luke 22, and John 18, the fact that Pastor Jason mentioned it 2 weeks ago, the fact that Peter denied Jesus 3 times, right? He denied him. Why? Because Jesus was being persecuted. Jesus was going to be hung on a cross. And Peter is saying, wait a minute, if they're doing that to me and they're accusing me to being with him, hello, I can put 2 and 2 together, they're going to lynch me. Maybe I shouldn't use that word because it was really, really bad. But Peter was more concerned about his own skin. He was concerned about his own skin and saving his own skin. And we know that Jesus has said before that he who's willing to lose his life for my sake will gain it, right? But now look at what Peter tells the people hearing. He says, you, with the help of wicked men, put him to death by nailing him on the cross. So he's accusing them. He's getting up with the 11, and by the way, I love that part, because when he stood up, he didn't stand up alone. All right, we read that. That was right at the beginning. So we're standing with other believers, and he's saying, you, along with other wicked men, put him to death. A disciple is someone who has been transformed by the power of the Spirit. I have a couple of stories, but I'm not going to share them for the sake of time. See, this transformation that we see here in Peter's life, let's not get it twisted. Let's not get it upside down. This was to Peter's benefit at first, but it didn't stay there. See, this transformation happened in Peter's life, and therefore, the Spirit of God made Peter an instrument of transformation, a vehicle of transformation. Making disciples begin by sharing the story of Jesus, the hope, love, kindness, mercy, forgiveness. I put it this way, it's like we share our lives, we share the miracles, but we also share the message. Look at what happened after Peter shared the message. Acts 2, 36 through 41. Verse 36. Therefore, let all Israel be assured of this. God has made this Jesus, again, whom you crucified, both Lord and Messiah. You can't separate the two. Verse 37, when the people heard this, they were cut to the heart and said to Peter and the other apostles, brothers, what shall we do? Peter replied, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of sins, and you will receive the gifts of the Holy Spirit. The promise is for you, for your children, and for all who are far off, for all whom the Lord our God will call. With many other words, he warned them, and he pleaded with them, save yourselves from this corrupt generation. Those who accepted his message were baptized, and about 3,000 were added to their number that day. The boldness of verse 36. All of Israel, this Jesus whom you humiliated, this Jesus whom you ridiculed, this Jesus whom you rejected, this Jesus, God made him Lord and Messiah. Now, this is a very different Peter than the one that we read in Matthew when he's hiding. Very different Peter. And that's what the Spirit of God in a man or in a woman or in a child is able to do. This is the Peter that some could label as he is screw-up prone, uneducated coward, or a hot-tempered fool. This is the same Peter. So I want to ask you, Good News family, what label are you still holding on to? I'm going to say that again. What label are you still holding on to? Because I put a lot of but before God. And the Holy Spirit will convict me of something. I say, God, but. And he'll destroy that one. And then he will convict me and I'll be, no, God, but. It gets to a point where my transformation cannot just be for me. It gets to a point where what God has done inside of me has to come out. It must come a point where I no longer am okay with just being an undercover agent. Because if I'm going to be an agent of transformation, I cannot be undercover. I think that was for somebody. See, an agent of transformation is we've been forgiven so we can forgive. We've been blessed so we can be a blessing. We have been transformed so we can bring transformation. See, I know that Jesus is the one that does the transforming. Don't get me wrong. But he uses people. I give my life to Jesus because an ex-gangbanger, an ex-gang member who turned his life around and became detective in the LAPD shared a message that I could not get away from. That as these men are saying here and women, as we're reading, I was cut to the heart. Because God revealed how wicked I was. So God used that man. So yeah, God did the transformation, but he used that man. And I'm forever thankful. Don't even know his name. Don't need to know. But his reward will be in heaven. I shared with you guys that a few weeks ago that, a couple of weeks ago, that the first step of being a disciple is trusting Jesus for salvation. That's the first step. Trusting Jesus with your life. Saying, you know what? I don't have to understand it all. I know that I'm a sinner. I know that I need God. I know that I need forgiveness. So I'm just going to do this, Jesus. Give you my life. That's what I had to do. It's the very first step. And that's what these people were asking Peter and the others. What must we do? What must we do? Repent and be baptized. And perhaps you're in this room, you're watching online, and you're asking, Raphael, what must I do? I'm going to tell you, repent. That means turn away from your sin and turn towards Jesus and be baptized. What does that mean? Baptism is going into water. Going down is a symbol of something that has happened in here. We give our lives, so we go down in the water, we come back up. It's a resurrected person, individual. It's a symbol, but it's a powerful symbol. So I'm going to ask you a couple of questions. Do you ever talk about Jesus with people around you? Do you ever talk about Jesus with people around you? And the second question is closely tied to that first one. When you talk about Jesus in front of others, does it cut them to the heart? Does it cut them to the heart, or it causes them to be appalled by Jesus? There is a difference. If I share Jesus and someone says, man,
I need what you have. Or when I talk about Jesus, does it cause others to be like, whoa, man, nah, I don't want any part of that. See, there is a tension. And I heard our speaker this week. We went to the District Council of the Assemblies of God, and there was a brother, man of God, that came and shared some things. And there is a tension between love and truth when we talk about Jesus. And this is a reality, because there's some truth that I cannot deny if I'm going to talk to you about Jesus. But there's also the love of Jesus that I cannot deny. And he shared this story. He says, like, hey, you know, when he was young, he used to go in the fields and with his brother, and they used to go get in the into the field, and there was like muddy places and things, and they used to go in quicksand or whatever, and they used to get in there, and he used to say that they used to love the suck. Okay, not a bad word. Just when they step in there and they pull their feet up, they go like, you know, so you're like, yeah, and you know, and the boots were actually stay in there and all of that. But he says, like, one time he got in there, and then he was messing around and got stuck in the suck. So he is like going down, and he said, if his brother out here, who's out there on the outside, would have started with him with truth, right? Oh boy, you're gonna be in trouble. Oh man, when mom sees what you got into, she, you gonna get a whooping, boy. Right? Said, man, you may die in there. Well, I don't know what you're gonna do, but you're in trouble. That's truth, right? Like, that's nothing but truth. But when somebody's in the midst of the mess, truth is not going to help them. What helps is the love. Him reaching out and say, hey, brother, I'm going to get you out. I'm going to get you out. I'm going to grab you, pull you out of that suck, out of that getting stuck in the suck, right? I'm going to pull you out. And now when you out here, I could beat the living daylights out of you for being so stupid, right? When I get you out of the mess, now you out here, I'm going to tell you, man, that was stupid. Why'd you do that? I'm going to give you all the truth in the world. But guess what? I already rescued you. So that's the difference. I want you to think too about that whenever you're sharing Jesus. See, because Jesus is the most interesting individual in the world. Jesus is the most loving. Jesus is the sexiest, if I can say that. Some of you ladies that are single are not like, ooh, my goodness. Oh, guys, too. You know what I'm talking about. He's attractive. But some of them have made him to look like he's some ugly duckling over here. And again, I'm not telling you because I know how it goes. And I'm going to get messages from people that say, well, you just want a seeker-friendly. You just want to dilute the gospel. No, I'm telling you to do what Jesus did. A woman that was caught in adultery, Jesus did not go up to her and says, you are so stupid. You know that the word of God says, right? The word of God, if we go to preach it, you shall not lust and you shall not covet your neighbor's wife or her husband or whatever. No. Jesus told her the truth and said, hey, go and sin no more. Neither do I condemn you. And he is actually one that could condemn her, because he has the authority to do so. Anyway. Okay, we're going to close with this. Can we stand? 2 Corinthians. I love 2 Corinthians chapter 3, by the way. Love it, love it, love it. If you got a chance, just go read and ask God what he reveals to you through it. But 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 18 says this. And we all, with unveiled faces, contemplate the Lord's glory and are being transformed into his image with ever increasing glory, which comes from the Lord, who is Spirit. Oh, I love that. I love that. We all, not just two or three of us, we all, who with unveiled faces contemplate the Lord's glory, are being transformed. Being is present tense. It continues to happen. We're being transformed into his image with ever increasing glory. We reflect God's glory and his awesomeness. We're being transformed. You're still being transformed. We must be all in. We must pack our coffins. Because guess what? One of these days, this earth will be no more. And the things that we accumulate, not going to get us anywhere. What matters are the things that get transferred to our eternal account. I'm going to ask you this in closing. So we know that a disciple of Christ is sacrificial, relational, and transformational. I got three questions for you. What's God asking you to sacrifice in order to be all in with Him? What relationships do you need to invest in? And what step will you take to bring transformation to someone's life? I want you to think about it this way. One thing, one person, one step. Can you guys put those questions up there? One thing, one person, one step. So you can take a picture of that. But I want you to be thinking about one thing. And God may already have been convicting you of it. It's one thing that you need to give me. What is it? Is it my finances? Is it my relationships? Is it my control that I always feel like I need to be in control? What is it? Think of one person that you're going to invest in. So one thing, one person, and one step. What step are you going to take to bring transformation to someone's life? One tangible step. It could be a name of a person that you're going to take to lunch, that you're going to have coffee with, that you're going to ask them how they're doing, and you're going to get into their life and invite them into yours. All right, I want to pray for you. First, I want to pray for salvation, and then I want to pray for Holy Spirit to come upon you and make you His witness. Because see, Holy Spirit in us is not only so we can speak in tongues and edify our spirit. It's not only so we can prophesy, so we can edify the church. It's also so that we can bring this message, the story of Jesus, to people around us, that they in turn may be transformed as well. Number one, I want to pray for those that have not made a decision to follow Jesus. This is not for you to follow at a distance. This is for you to actually get close to Him, that He messes you up. Okay? So I'm going to count to three, and I'm going to ask you to lift up your hands. The reason why I'm counting to three is because I want you to be ready. I want you to in your heart, to begin to think through, man, I need to do this. And I've been feeling this way since I came in this place. One, you're ready to give your life to Jesus. Number two, you're ready to become a disciple of Jesus. Number three, you can lift your hand if that's you. That's you. I want to see your hands if that's you. And I want to pray for you and with you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, sir. All right, let's do this. Let's pray. Praise God. Amen. Praise the Lord. All right, this is what we're going to do. The whole church is going to help us pray. And I need you to pray out loud if you lift your hands. And then I need you to tell somebody. Tell somebody. Even if it's the person next to you right there, you could come and tell one of the pastors. You could tell somebody that you did this. And we want the opportunity to disciple you, to help you walk through this with some people. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, I ask you to forgive me. Cleanse me from all my sins. I choose to follow you for the rest of my life. Transform my heart and my mind. I'm all yours. Thank you for salvation. Thank you for your love and compassion and mercy. In Jesus' name, amen. Now, how many of you would say, hey, I don't know if I'm filled with the Spirit of God? Anybody? I don't know if I'm filled with the Spirit of God. I need to be filled with the Spirit like Peter was in this manner, so I'll be bold in communicating the message. Anybody? Just a hand. Okay, I see one hand. Anybody else? I see another one. Okay, see a couple. All right, let me pray over you. Father, and for those of you online as well, that's you, raise your hand. All right, Pastor Jason is saying invite them down here. Okay, so we're going to do that. I'm going to pray with you individually. So if you guys would come down. You're talking about doing it right here? at the end. Okay, we're going to do that at the end. So just come and pray with me. But Father, thank you so much for your people. Thank you for the message. I pray, God, that you continue to challenge us with your word and by your spirit, God. We thank you. I thank you so much for this good news family, for their faithfulness, for their goodness, for their courage, God. I pray that they will go and share this message. One thing, one person, one step, God. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you. Good news.